Matthew chapter 24, starting verse 35. We all want to know when the Lord's coming back. But the scripture says only the Father knows. But he did tell us what to look for in Matthew 24. And let's start in verse 35 through 38. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words shall not pass away. But on that day, but of that day and hour, knoweth no man, no, not the angels of heaven, but my Father only. But as the days of Noah were, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. For as in the days that were before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying, giving in marriage, until the day that Noah entered into the ark. And now I'm going to turn back over into Genesis. You don't have to turn there. I'll read it. Genesis chapter 6, 5 through 8 says this. And God saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. And it repented the Lord that he had made man on this earth, and it grieved him in his heart. And the Lord said, I will destroy man whom I have created from the face of the earth, both man and beast and creeping thing, fowls of the air, for he repenteth me that I have made them. But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. It's really a time that we need to start getting serious about the Lord. I think Noah was about 500 years old when he started his family. Do you think we started ours a little too quick? We might be a little quick in our day and time. Then Noah lived on 600 years, then the flood. And he lived on to be 950 years old. He saw the end of time for everyone except his family. The end of time for everyone except his family. Now today we're flying down the road with the top down and headed toward the same thing as Noah saw. Jesus said it. I believe it. He said they were eating, drinking, marrying, giving in marriage until the day Noah entered the ark. In Noah's time, the scripture said, in every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually, which means he was thinking evil all the time. All the time. But Noah, he found grace in the Lord's eyes. What do you think our Lord sees today in this world? I imagine what he thinks today. I cannot imagine what he thinks today. We certainly have people eating and drinking and marrying and divorcing and cheating on one another. And I see that, but I cannot see their hearts and minds. But our Father can. We can look around and see it, but are we really checking on our own minds and our own hearts? How are we living? I want to find grace in our Lord's eye. We've got to check on our own lives. We've got to get the beam out of our own eye before we can get the splinter out of someone else's eye. We today always seem like we're worrying about somebody else and what they're doing instead of our own lives and how we're living. Yes, times are different now, but I still want to find grace in the Lord's eye. Have you ever thought about that? Thinking how God looks at you and how that you're living for Him and how you're lifting Him up, or how you're not living for Him and not lifting Him up. And my prayer today is that each and every one of us today want the same thing. Find grace in the Lord's eye. No one knows the day or the hour, so let's be ready every day. Every hour, prayed up, Bibled up, and ready to meet Jesus. For He could come back any day. No one knows. I know I've heard it all my life. Oh, He's coming back, He's coming back. But when I was younger, I just really didn't realize the things that were really going on around me. Today, I see things. I read the Bible, and I see how things is coming about. I believe He's coming back according to His Word. And I believe it's coming soon. I really do. According to what Jesus said. Now, it's nothing that I say. I just read the Bible and try to interpret the best I can. We cannot afford to take it too seriously. That's what a lot of people say. But yes, we do have to take it seriously. Our lives and our families' families depend on it. It's all at stake. We need to do the best we can to keep our families on the right track. I've not been working this past week, and I spent a lot of time in front of the TV, sadly to say. Of course, I watch a lot of Westerns, but now they're getting bad. But anyway, I watched a few of the nominations for the Speaker of the House this week, and I've never seen such a bunch of babies as they are running our country. It's sad if you look at it. That's the reason I don't ever watch it, because it just gets me aggravated. But this week I had a little time and I watched a little of that. It's sad. It's sad to think, you know, what's going on in our country. And this word that Jesus gave us about coming back, we better take it to heart and we better get serious. We better get serious and try to find grace in the Lord's eye. I'll tell you, it's a privilege to be here in the Lord's house. You talk to people that can't get out, and you'll see how much they want to be here. I went down and visited Paige and Betty this week, and I'm telling you, what a blessing. I was going down there to try to encourage them because they're sick, and I come out happy and shouting for the Lord. Them people they're blessed and they know it, and they want to share it. They want to be here. Most people that can't get here to church really want to be in the Lord's house, and we come, and a lot of times we just take it for granted. We can't even say amen or raise our hands and praise the Lord or come to the choir and help sing. That's one thing that Paige said, I really miss being in the choir and just singing and praising the Lord. We need to really remember those that can't get out. If you get a chance to call Betty and Paige, call them, and go see them. They said, anybody come anytime, we're glad to see them. But let's don't let down on the Lord. Let's keep living for Him and glorifying Him. Anybody got a word for the Lord this morning? Amen. I'm just thankful to be saved this morning. Thankful to be saved. Anybody else? Okay, before we go to our classes, this see if anybody has made a new lease on this new year. How many of you wives told your husbands you loved them? This week. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18. That's the most we've ever had. 18. All right, how many of you men told your wives you loved them? Let's see them hands now. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. Oh, you men better. I've got the, you know, I'll give you the praise for that, doing a little better. We could do a whole lot better. 17 and 13, pretty good. Out of 500, pretty good. You love the Lord, say amen. Going to be in the book of Ruth again. Last time we stopped at chapter 2, verse 17, but I'm going to back up just a little bit to 14. Verse 14 of chapter 2. But let's look back for a minute in case there were some people that weren't here. So, Ruth and Naomi. Naomi was Ruth's mother-in-law. They both lost their husbands. They were living in a place called Moab, which was a pretty bad place, pretty wicked place. They decided to return to Bethlehem, and she actually had two sons. Both of them died at the time, along with her husband, don't know how. And her two daughter-in-laws, she tries to get them both to stay and go back to their families. And they were both Moabite women, both Gentiles. One of them was Ruth. One of them was named Orpah. Orpah decides to go back to her family and go back to her way of life. So Ruth decides to go with her mother-in-law. They return to Bethlehem, Judah. They're poor and destitute. They have no way to make a living. Things are not very good for them. So, Ruth goes out to glean in a field. She gets permission from her mother-in-law to go glean. And that's how they would make their living. They would glean the fields and pick up what was left after the harvesters came through. Just so happens that she ends up in the field of Boaz. And Boaz was a well-off man. He was a Jew, apparently pretty wealthy, upright man,
in the community, and he has his eye on Ruth, and he inquires about her, and they end up meeting, and he gives her permission to glean, and he actually commands his blessing on her, which is where we left off, and he as a matter of fact, he tells his men to let her glean wherever she wants to, even in the stuff that hasn't been harvested yet, the good stuff. And he tells them to drop a little bit extra for her on purpose, just to help her out. So he's got his eye on her. He commands his blessing on her. And he even tells her to come eat at his table at mealtime, drink of my well. He commands his men to look after her and protect her, keep their hands off of her. And we also talked about types in the book of Ruth. And Boaz is our type of Christ here. And what I mean by that, I don't want you to take that the wrong way. We're not comparing him to Christ, but he is a representation of Christ in the Old Testament. It is almost a, I would call it a prophecy here. I mean, this book was written long before the New Testament. And this is painting a perfect picture of what Christ did for us. And Ruth, obviously, in the story, she's a Gentile, but her type is also as us. She's representing us as Gentiles and how we get grafted into Christ. Because, like I said, her being a Gentile, marrying a Jew, was not common. That wasn't the custom of the time. And for Boaz to even have his eye on her was out of the ordinary at this time. All right. I think we're halfway caught up. Let's look at chapter 2, verse 14. And this is right after Boaz addresses her and tells her that to eat at my table, drink of my well. Says, and when she was risen up to glean, Boaz commanded his young men, saying, let her glean even among the sheaves, and reproach her not, and let fall also some of the handfuls of purpose for her, and leave them that she may glean them, and rebuke her not. So she gleaned in the field until even, and beat out that she had gleaned, and it was about an ephah of barley, which was a lot. Probably more than the average person would glean in a day. It was an unusual amount. It made me think of over in Luke when they were bringing in the nets, and the nets broke. They had so many fish that the nets broke, and they couldn't even bring them in. I think that's how she felt right here. I did a little research on barley and how they harvested it. It was a grain. What they would do is, in the field, they would cut it. It grew up just like wheat on a stalk. So they would cut the stalk, and they would bundle it. And a lot of times they would let it dry. Sometimes they wouldn't. But they would bundle it up. And when they had several bundles, they would lay it out on a sheet, and they would beat the ends of the grains off the stick, and then they would throw the chaff away, or not the chaff, but the stalks away. They would take all the ends and put them in a bucket, but as we know from other stories, there's always chaff in the wheat, and the only way to separate this is they would take this bucket, and on a windy day, they would lay another bucket out, and they would dump it out, and let the wind carry the chaff away, because the chaff was lighter than the actual grain itself. So the wind would blow the chaff away, and the pile that was left here was your good stuff, and the pile that was blown further down, that was your chaff. That was the garbage. They didn't want chaff. And they would actually burn it, because they didn't want that seed getting back into their fields. And I know we've all heard about separating wheat from the chaff and burning the chaff. of people now, they would use, which nowadays they use harvesters, and none of this is really applicable now, but some people back then would use a fan to blow it, but if you didn't have a fan, you had to wait for the wind to blow. And I thought about the Pool of Bethesda. They had to sit around and wait till the water got stirred. So the lesson that I kindly take from that right there was, anybody ever heard of making hay while the sun's shining? You got to make hay while the sun's shining. If you cut hay and let it sit on the ground and rain on it, it's ruined. It'll mold and mildew. And I feel the same way about this. They had to wait till the wind was blowing. They didn't get to just decide when they were going to separate. They had to do it whenever the wind blew. And that's the same for us today, spiritually. We don't get to decide God's schedule, and we don't get to make the schedule of the Holy Spirit. We got to wait on the wind to blow. And when the wind blows, we better move. We better take advantage of it, because, like I said, we're on His time and on His schedule. You better act on it. You better take it in when the Holy Spirit's moving. Now, like I said, some people would bind it up and they would store it and let it dry before they knocked the heads off. But Ruth didn't do that. As a matter of fact, she removed the stalks right away instead of waiting. And as I thought about that, there was no reason for her to carry that straw home, because that was garbage. There was no good in it. She was just carrying dead weight. She had to carry all that home. So it was a lot easier for her to go ahead and get rid of the stalks and get the good stuff and take it home. And she didn't have to carry all of it home. And I thought about, as Christians, if we're honest, a lot of the things that we remember from church are just the things that we don't like, and we carry those things home. And we leave the grain laying there in the field, and we'll gather up all the stalks and carry them home. And it's just dead weight. And I'm just being honest here. This is just for the church here. It's not just for us, but for the church in general. We remember something or somebody that we didn't like. And just like Ruth did here, we need to cut that off right there in the field and leave it laying and not carry it home. We just need to take home the good stuff. We need to find the wheat and the grain and take it home. As a matter of fact, Spurgeon, there's a little, I found a little quote from him. He said that a hen would pick over a whole bushel of chaff to find one little grain of wheat, while critics or church members will pick through a whole bushel of wheat to find one little bit of chaff and carry it home. Yeah. I mean, that's just the truth, isn't it? I mean, if we're honest, we need to be more like that hen. All right, I'm going to read 17 through 19 here, moving on. She gleaned in the field until evening, beat out that she had gleaned, and it was about an ephah of barley. And like I said, that was a lot more than she probably should have harvested. I mean, that was an unusually large amount. And she took it up and went into the city, and her mother-in-law saw what she had gleaned, and she brought forth and gave to her that she had reserved after she was sufficed. And her mother-in-law said unto her, "Where hast thou gleaned today, and where wroughtest thou? Blessed be he that did take knowledge of thee." And she showed her mother-in-law with whom she had wrought, and said, "The man's name with whom I wrought today is Boaz." So Naomi was surprised when Ruth got home and she saw how much she had gleaned. And I think she knew that somebody had been helping her. Something was up here. Because she asked her, she said, "Where did you glean today? Where did you get all this?" There's no way she did that without help. And she said, "Blessed be he that did take knowledge of thee." And that goes right back to Psalm 8, like we talked about. What is man that you would even take knowledge of him, talking about God. What is man? And that's, she repeats the same thing here. Blessed is he that did even take knowledge of you, Ruth. And Naomi said unto her daughter-in-law, blessed be he of the Lord, who hath not left off his kindness to the living and to the dead. And Naomi said unto her, the man is near kin unto us, one of our next kinsmen. Now Naomi understands what this means. This is a big deal. You need to underline this. The fact that he's a near kinsman may not have meant much to Ruth, because she wasn't, I don't think she was accustomed to the law at this time. But what that meant, like we talked about before, I know it's been a while, but being that he was next of kin, he could, one, redeem the land that was Naomi's, and he could also perform the Levirate marriage and raise up kids to Ruth and keep the family name. Blessed be he of the Lord. Luke 1:68. Let me look at that real quick. You don't have to turn there. I'm gonna read it to you. There was somebody else. This was mentioned over here in the birth. I'm gonna read you 67-70. It says, and his father Zacharias was filled with the Holy Ghost and prophesied, saying, blessed be he of the Lord of Israel, for he hath visited and redeemed his people, and hath raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David, and as he spake by the mouth of his holy prophets, which have been since the world began. And that verse 70 right there, I think that is a direct reference to right here. Blessed be he of the Lord, for he hath visited and redeemed his people. And that's exactly what Boaz is about to do right here in the book of Ruth. So I want to talk about Naomi for a minute. I know we've talked about types. So Boaz is a type of Christ, right? Ruth is representing us in this story. What about Naomi? What do y'all think Naomi would represent? And this is not concrete. This is just my opinion, but I want to hear your opinion. What do you think about Naomi? What would she represent? Exactly what I thought. So she guides, instructs, teaches her, convicts her. That's the same exact thing the Holy Spirit does for us. You see how Naomi is kindly whispering in her ear the whole time, giving her instructions, because remember, Ruth was a Gentile. She did not know this way of life. She didn't know their laws. She was completely foreign to this. But the whole time, Ruth kindly has her under her wing and guides her through all this. So keep that in mind with Naomi being a type of the Holy Spirit. Verse 21, and Ruth the Moabitess said, he said unto me also, thou shalt keep fast by my young men until they have ended all my harvest. And Naomi said unto Ruth, her daughter-in-law, it is good, my daughter, that thou go out with his maidens, that they meet thee not in any other field. So she kept fast by the maidens of Boaz to glean under the end of the harvest, under the end of the barley harvest and of the wheat harvest, and dwelt with her mother-in-law. Now we're going to get into chapter 3 right here. This is where Naomi really starts giving her some instruction. And the first three verses right here is what I really want to teach on today. I want to focus on this. I've got 3 points right here that I want to look at. And they fit all of us really good right here. It's a lesson for everybody if we'll take it in. All right, chapter 3 says, then Naomi, her mother-in-law, said unto her, my daughter, shall I not seek rest for thee, that it may be well with thee? Now, if you remember in chapter 1, let me just read you this. Naomi was praying for this. She said, "The Lord grant you." This is right when she tells both daughter-in-laws to go back to their families and not to follow her. She says, "The Lord grant you that you may find rest, each of you, in the house of her husband." Then she kissed him, and they lifted up their voice and wept. And then right over here, just a few chapters later, God's worked it out to where she's going to find rest with potentially a future husband right here. "And now is not Boaz of our kindred, with whose maidens thou wast? Behold, he winnoweth barley tonight in the threshing floor." And now winnowing barley is what we just talked about. They had cut it, and they take the heads off of it, and they sift it and separate it. And what they would do after they did this that day, and you got to remember, this was their big harvest for the year, so they would have all this barley piled up, and they would sleep there that night so nobody would come steal it. And they would stay with it. And this is what Boaz was doing. So she gives her three specific instructions right here. And this is for the new Christian. This is a story of salvation. I just want you to see salvation right here and see Jesus. She says, "Wash thyself, therefore, and anoint thee, and put thy raiment upon thee, and get thee down to the floor, but make not thyself known unto the man, until he shall have done eating and drinking." So, Naomi's given her instructions for the Levirate marriage. If we look at this in dimension one, she's given her instructions because she wants her to be prepared. She's preparing Ruth to be a bride for the Levirate marriage. And dimension number two is for me and you. The Bible gives us these same instructions in the New Testament to prepare ourselves for the bride, to be a bride for the coming of Christ. I want you to parallel all this stuff. Number one, she says, "Wash thyself." Why would you wash yourself? What's the number one reason we wash ourselves? We're dirty. That's conviction. The first thing, in order to get saved, you have to be lost, right? If we're not dirty, if we don't sin, there's no need to be saved. If you don't understand that you're a sinner and that you have fallen short of the glory of God, you cannot be saved. Let's look at the New Testament now, Ephesians 5:25. I'll read it to you. This is right after my favorite verse in the Bible, where it says, "So let the wives submit to their husbands." Is that anybody else's favorite verse? I'm just kidding. Listen, 5:25, "Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it, that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word, that he might present it to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish." So this is giving instructions for us as Christians to cleanse ourselves and make ourselves ready for the marriage. How do we symbolize that in today's time, how do we symbolize that washing? Repenting, but there's something we do. We baptize. I spent the last half of this week building a baptistry for a church in town, and it's pretty neat. I've been thinking about baptism a lot this week, so. It struck me that that's our symbol. And don't get me wrong, there's nothing holy about the water or the baptistry or anything like that. It's a symbol of holiness is what it is. But that's what we do. That's the whole purpose of our baptism, is a symbol of the washing of ourselves, preparing ourselves for the groom. We are the bride. Titus 3:5 says, "Not by works of righteousness we have done, but according to his mercy, he has saved us by the washing of regeneration and the renewing of the Holy Ghost." So the symbolism is when we come back out of the water, we have been washed and cleansed, and regenerated and renewed in the Holy Ghost. What was the second thing she told her to do? She said, "Anoint thee." Now, we talk a lot about the anointing, but what does it really mean? I know you've heard Eric talk about the anointing before. What does it mean to have the anointing? Covered in the blood. Yeah. Spirit led. That's what I was looking for. I guess the definition that I found was the indwelling presence of the Holy Spirit, to guide us through the Word of God, to teach us, convict us, and give us understanding. And when you hear Eric talk about the anointing, he's receiving words from the Holy Spirit and giving them to you. And he's just a messenger giving you the word from the Holy Spirit. Just like Ruth here, she's receiving instructions from her mother-in-law on what to do to perform this marriage and to make herself ready for the marriage. First John 2:27, "But the anointing which ye have received of him abideth in you, and ye need not that any man teach you, but as the same anointing teacheth you of all things, and is truth, and is no lie, and even as it hath taught you, ye shall abide in him." Yeah, and the anointing isn't, I mean, it's not just for preaching or teaching. I mean, it could be singing. I mean, there's people that I know that their anointing is just by being around the people that they work with. I mean, that's their ministry, if you want to call it that. But don't put that in a box. I mean, you've got to let that go where it wants to go, because that's the Holy Spirit guiding you. What was the third thing? This is the last thing we're going to talk about, and we'll be done. She says, "Put thy raiment upon thee." This is where we're going to talk about Jesus right here. What raiment is she talking about? Best garment. Because she was, I mean, this was supposed to be like a marriage. Isaiah 61:10, I'm going to read this to you. It says, "I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My soul shall be joyful in my God, for he hath clothed me with the garments of salvation." Remember, I told you we're talking about salvation here. We're talking about the Levirate marriage, but we're talking about mine and your salvation. This is for me and you. "He hath covered me with the robe of righteousness, as a bridegroom decketh himself with ornaments, and as a bride adorneth herself with her jewels." 2 Corinthians 5:21. I'm going to end up with this. Listen, this is what I want you to really take from today. "For he hath made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him." And let me just make it as simple as I know how to make it for you. what this is talking about here, all the way back in Ruth. I want you to remember something. This was wrote way before Jesus came back. This was a long time ago. Tell me this book isn't inspired. It's as simple as this. He traded coats with us. And this is the way I see it. Me and you, we wear a coat of sin, filthiness. It's flesh. That's what it is. And not much good in it, are they? All Jesus did was he took off our coat of unrighteousness and filthiness and put it on himself, and in turn, he took our punishment for us. He put on the coat of sin unto death and gave us his coat of righteousness unto eternal life. And if you want to read about that, you can go over there into Revelation, and there's several other places where he talks about a white robe. I want you to remember that. Just